This is Warren Vanderbilt interviewing Dr. Marilyn Nathan, Muncie Jewish Oral History Project 2, January 17, 2003. Marilyn, I want to thank you for agreeing to participate in the study, and I want to begin by asking you a question that doesn't really have anything to do, or much to do, with the Jewish Oral History Project, and that is to ask why you came to Muncie in the first place, and if there were other options you might have had at that point in your life.
I came to Muncie because I was married to a man who was teaching at the university, and so no, I did not see other options at that time in my life. It seemed the most reasonable thing to do.
Okay. When you first came to Muncie, back in the 1960s, if I recall.
1961?
Yeah. What did you think of the community?
I was surprised at how small it was, having come from the East Coast in a much larger type of congregation.
Yeah. What do you think of it now? Lo, these many years later.
It's an interesting question, and I feel like I belong in it. And I suspect over the years what has happened is I eventually acclimated to the type of community it is and feel very comfortable in it now and very involved in it.
Okay. How would you describe your life as a member of a Jewish community, or given that you've lived in various places, Jewish communities, before you came to Muncie?
Before I came to Muncie, I lived in Connecticut. It was a very large Jewish community, and my social life was very involved with the Jewish community in Danbury, Connecticut. I don't find that's quite as true here in Muncie. That's one of the differences. It was also a more conservative synagogue, and as I get older, I find I'm much more comfortable in a Reform synagogue.
Since I know you as well as I do, go back to Queens.
Prior to marriage life.
Yeah, talk about what it was like to be a member of the Jewish community in Queens.
It was great. I was a member of the Kew Gardens Jewish Center. On Saturday nights as a teenager, we went there to dances when there was no date available. Most of our social teen activities were involved in the temple there. And most of the community that participated in the temple functions lived in the same area as I did, so it felt kind of a lot like one cohesive family. And we were pretty interdependent on each other. I found that to be very different in Muncie.
Probably apples and oranges.
Yeah.
Knowing a little bit about the area where you grew up.
And the emphasis was different too. Muncie does not have a permanent rabbi. There was always a rabbi available. Not that as a teenager I took much advantage of that, but other members of the congregation did.
How large was that congregation, just out of my own curiosity?
Pardon?
How large was that congregation?
Oh, God, I can't remember.
It was huge.
It was huge. I mean, we're talking 600-700 people.
Okay. Was that Reformed or conservative?
Conservative.
Yeah, exactly.
But it was lightly conservative, they used to consider themselves, which was somewhere between Reform and conservatism.
Okay. What has your life been like as a member of the Jewish community since you came to Muncie?
Well, initially I was very active in the Jewish community when I came to Muncie. After my divorce, I chose not to be for several years. In the past 3 years, I have gotten myself back into the community. I think what spurred that on was the death of my mother and the need to follow a ritualistic procedure in mourning her, which was very helpful to me. Larry Francis, who was a very good friend of mine, also was encouraging me to join the temple by stating every week, it's about time you do this. And I eventually did 3 years ago, and I'm very glad. It's a very spiritually fulfilling thing for me now.
How important is Temple Beth El in your life now?
It's really important. If I miss a Sabbath service, I feel not guilty, I just feel not fulfilled. I feel uncomfortable.
In the first study of the Muncie Jewish community that Dwight Hoover and I did now 23 years ago, we asked each of the participants in that study to talk a little bit about relationships between Jewish people in Muncie and non-Jewish members of this community. And the question I'm asking people in this set of interviews is whether or not you think that's a valid issue anymore. I mean, as you know, it was a really burning issue 23 years ago.
You know, I guess personally I don't think it's a valid issue anymore. I know that there are some things that happen that irritate members of the congregation, some kinds of insensitivities. Certainly one of the churches putting out crosses for all the people who died, not having any sensitivity to Jewish issues. is one of them. I think you find that anywhere in the world, though. I'm not sure I feel this is unique to Muncie anymore.
Have you ever experienced any overt or covert anti-Semitism in your life?
Absolutely.
Okay.
When I taught in Jay County.
Okay.
Between 1971 and 1980, I was an art teacher first in Dunkirk and then in Portland. When I taught in Portland, I walked into my art room one day and somebody had very, quote, nicely, unquote, etched swastikas into the wall in my room. I was very upset and angry. That was my second experience. My first experience happened in Dunkirk when I explained to one of the students that I was not going to be there the next day because it was Yom Kippur and that they were to behave for the substitute. He didn't know what the holiday was, and when I explained it, he said to me, "Are you a Jewish?" And I said, "Yes." And he said, "But you don't have horns. My daddy said Jewishes have horns." And I said, "Well, go home and tell your daddy this one doesn't." And I found that very disturbing.
Rural Indiana.
Yes.
In all its glory.
Kind of scary.
Yeah.
But, you know, that was many years ago. I'm not sure I would find the same thing if I went back to Jay County today. I have no way to evaluate that.
How do you see the future of Temple Bethel?
I'm not really sure how to answer that. I would like to see the congregation keep going. I think it's a difficult task before us. Of course, like any other religious group, we have financial problems. We have a task force we're putting together to see if it would be possible to have a full-time rabbi in conjunction with some type of an endowed chair at the university. And I think that would be a great way to ensure that our temple would continue to function. Unfortunately, most of us are over 30.
Yeah, right.
And we don't seem to have many young people moving into the congregation. And as people's children become of age, they leave the area. And so I don't know what's going to happen to us. I hope we will stay as cohesive a group as we are now.
Okay. Talk some more about the issue of a full-time rabbi, because when I did these interviews 23 years ago, that issue came up in almost all of the interviews that I did. And I guess I was a little surprised when I began this set of interviews that here, almost a quarter of a century later, people were still talking about the same thing. And why is it so important to try to figure out some way to have someone here?
Well, I think like any other religious group, perhaps we would like to have a spiritual leader that is available to us. The student rabbis are very good and work very hard. I'm 65 years old. It would be very hard for me to go and discuss some personal problems with a 22-year-old student. I think that's probably one issue for many members of the congregation. There's also the issue of continuity within the congregation, services, and kind of Judaism, to me at least, is more than a religion. It's a kind of way of life, a cultural thing. And we have difficulty with continuity with a student rabbi who comes every other weekend and is never here in the summer. I just think that religious communities benefit from having a spiritual leader on a full-time basis. Now, given the size of our congregation, there is no way we can ever afford to do this by ourselves. This would be impossible.
Okay.
Given some of the things that have been left to our synagogue and possibilities of future endowments, it would be very nice to have someone who would be able to provide religious studies at the university as well as serve our congregation.
Okay. One of the issues that has come up in a lot of the interviews, and again it was present 23 years ago, but probably not mentioned by a majority of the persons I interviewed, is the role of non-Jewish spouses in the congregation. And I mean, you've seen that happen over the years that you've been in Muncie, and I'd like you to comment on that from your perspective.
Well, I'm not sure I have a particular perspective on it. It has always been my understanding and certainly my own feeling that non-Jewish spouses are welcome and participate in our congregation. I don't see much animosity towards them. I think we all live in a world where we have multiple mixed type of marriages or partnerships.
Okay. That's pretty much it. I guess when I was going through the latest directory of Temple Bethel,
let me expand upon my feelings about that a little bit. In the past, there seemed to be some resistance, and now I'm talking about the past, the early 60s, to non-Jewish spouses participating in the community. it has been my experience, this is no longer true. There are several intermarried couples who seem to be very comfortable with both persons participating not only in the Jewish community, but in the religious community of the other spouse. And that's a nice, comfortable thing for me to see happening.
Okay.
It indicates that we've become more tolerant.
Yeah, I think that's definitely true. But going back to the point I made about going through the directory, I hadn't really thought much about this until I started looking at names and became aware that, especially with a number of the Ball State faculty, who are now quite active in the congregation, that they have non-Jewish spouses.
Yes.
And when I've interviewed some of them, they said, well, my spouse plays an important role,
yeah,
and is welcome. And I thought, well, gee.
And they participate in, like, the sisterhood circles,
yeah,
which provide for the Oneg Shabbat, which is the coffee hour after,
right,
services. And it's a very comfortable, nice thing. Plus, we don't end up being quite as isolated or secular that way. It's nice to have other ideas besides one's own.
This is a good time of the year for making wish lists. If there were to be a Marilyn Nathan wish list for the future of Temple Bethel, what 2, 3, 4, 5, whatever number you prefer, things might be on that list.
Well, top priority would be having a full-time rabbi. The second priority would be having air conditioning in the sanctuary. Goofy as that sounds, but it can get very hot.
No, you're the second person to mention
that. Oh, good. And I'm not the only one.
Yeah.
And what would my other priorities be? Maybe some more adult education. Enhancing the Sunday school.
Mm-hmm.
Although it's quite good, I think that, again, and it's always dollars.
Mm-hmm.
It would be nice to be able to pay someone to be a full-time supervisor of the Sunday school. The only way heritage gets handed down is by teaching from parent to child, and certainly we try to do our best with that, and in any case, there's always room for improvement in that area.
I'm assuming you wouldn't be averse to more endowed programs.
Oh, absolutely not. We'd love more endowed programs. I'd love to see us have a good library.
Hmm.
That would be a really neat thing. Right now, we have a very small library of books that are mostly donated by congregants, and some of them are religiously oriented and some of them aren't. It's very difficult in Muncie to do any research in a religious sense. Last year I got interested in reading the Kabbalah,
mm-hmm,
and it's not a problem to buy the book, but I couldn't just go to the,
right,
temple and find one. And finding someone to talk to about it was a little more difficult too. I had to wait for the weekend. The student rabbi was here,
oh,
who fortunately was interested in Kabbalah too.
How important to the future of the temple do you think the building addition is?
Oh, I think it's a great boon. I really do. We have many social occasions in there. We also have some types of services in there, depending on what the religious holiday is. It's a nice place for people to get together.
Okay. I've had a number
and
of people
it's air conditioned.
Get in the AC. I had people comment on the potential it has to develop the cultural side.
It certainly does. And I think we have a social cultural committee that does do some work in that area. And it's a very nice thing.
Okay.
And very helpful.
Okay. My working hypothesis for this study is something like this. No Ball State, no Ball Memorial Hospital, maybe no Temple Bethel.
That would be very frightening in all three areas.
Talk more about that, because you know a lot about one side of it. My point is that in the 23 years since I did the first study, and looking at the temple directory now, I was really taken back by the very large number of Ball State faculty and doctors, obviously brought here for the opportunity to practice medicine, many of them couples. And then began to think a little bit, knowing what the directory of the temple looked like 23 years ago, that today, if you pull those Ball State names out of there and you pull those medical doctor names out of there isn't a whole heck of a lot left.
No, there isn't. And I'm not sure the temple would survive in its current form.
Okay. Comment a little bit about in the recent past, how important do you think it is that these new people drawn here by academic opportunities at Ball State and by medical opportunities at the hospital, what they really represent to the future of the congregation?
I think they are the future of the congregation,
okay,
especially as the rest of us get old.
Well, you know, in what ways? Because you said a few moments ago that one of the things the congregation needs, and any congregation needs this, would be a greater infusion of younger people. Well, when you look at the majority of the younger people in the congregation, that is to say, people with young kids, a large number of them are people who are individuals brought here by the university and the hospital.
And hopefully in Indiana, in this environment, will provide opportunities for their children to stay here. That's not always a given. I don't think that the community without members, if you took out the members of the community who were employed either by the hospital or the university in some capacity,
right,
I think you would find a very, very small community struggling very hard to keep themselves together.
But there still would be a temple.
I think they would try to maintain it. You know, in a funny way, I'm affiliated with somebody in the university, and so if the university wasn't here, I wouldn't be here. But if I were here, I would certainly work my best to keep it going, to keep the congregation together.
Well, it comes up in funny ways, because even when you think of someone like Tom Steiner, who came here to open a coffee shop, I probably should have thought of this before I interviewed him, but I was really, again, struck by the fact that he wouldn't have opened that coffee shop in that location if it had not been for the University of
Washington. No, he would not, because it would not have made any sense to.
So there are other things that have to do with people coming here who affiliate with Temple Bethel, and they're not part of the university community, they're not part of the Ball Memorial Hospital community, but they're here because they're there.
That's right, and without them they wouldn't come here. The opportunities in Muncie would not be the same. In fact, I wonder what would, and frequently wonder what would happen to Muncie itself economically if the university were free from the city. And I think I know the answer to that.
Well, the answer is, as one of my students in the American History class once said, when I posed the question, what would Muncie be like without the university, and she raised her hand and said, Kokomo.
That's a little frightening. I was thinking, well, more, I was thinking more of Albany.
Oh, yeah. Well, those are the questions I have. Are there any other comments that you'd like to make, any other perspectives you'd like to share?
I'm really glad you're doing this study.
Oh, I appreciate
it. I think it would be neat to read it and to compare it to the previous study. I think when you put your notes together, you'll probably find many things have changed.
Oh, yeah.
And many things haven't.
Yeah, definitely true.
I suspect the basic feeling towards Judaism of the congregants hasn't. The need for spiritual involvement hasn't.
Yeah.
The makeup of the congregation really has.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's for the better, frankly. The growth is, in my opinion, always for the better.
Unquestionably. Thank you very much for participating in the study.